we're talking about this book that Ed found that we all found fascinating called How Not to Read the Bible by Dan Kimball.
Yep.
And so you can check that book out if you want to. But we're sort of unpacking some of the ideas in that book because we think it's so important in our day and age because the Bible has been misunderstood, misread.
It's being weaponized.
Weaponized against itself.
Yep.
So let's continue that discussion on some other things that we think are important for people to keep in mind as they read the Bible.
So I think, again, before we get into all the different kinds of specific things we want to talk about, like anti-scientific and all of those things that we listed last time, I think it's really important we go back to this idea, never read a verse or never read a Bible verse, and we talk about how you should read it.
Okay.
Because typically in our world, it is... So we said last time it's not written to you, but it is for you.
Yes.
That's important. So you've got to understand it was written to a group of people, all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So when somebody gives you a Bible verse, how would you guys start with that? Somebody, and I know all of us sort of do this naturally because we've been trained in it.
Sure.
Somebody says to me, what does a Bible verse mean? If I don't know it immediately, I look it up, and what am I looking for?
Mm-hmm. Well, when people come to me with that, I typically will... say, well, you know, where is this found?
Right.
Where did you get this if I don't have a reference? And I'm looking at the broader book that it was taken out of, because it does matter whether this verse came out of the book of First Peter or the Proverbs. You know what I mean?
That's right.
Because those are completely different.
So the genres
of books. So I'm looking at what book did this come out of, because honestly, if it came out of Proverbs, I'm certainly not going to take it as literal as I might take some coming out of somewhere else, because we all know the Proverbs are written as life principles.
That's right.
In fact, this is interesting. People may not know this, but you can find Proverbs within the same book that actually contradict one another.
That's right.
Because they're not trying to teach literal guidelines. They're teaching life principles that are generally true for you to think about. So... long story, I would start there and say, well, what book is this found? Is it Old Testament? Is it New Testament? And then just start narrowing down from there for me.
Yeah, me too.
That's good.
And, and then once you do that, and I do this almost always whenever, I see a verse reference and I look it up. I have a website that I use to look up Bible verses, and I type in. I never put the verse. I always put the chapter. Like, if the verse was Matthew, 2, verse 13,
oh, yeah.
I always put it in Matthew 2.
So I can read the whole chapter.
And then I scroll through the whole chapter, and I go, oh, okay, so before this is what Jesus was doing, and here's what happened. This is the story that it came out of, and now this is the exact verse, so that I can start getting my perspective on where this thing falls.
Yeah.
And then, once I've gotten that, I'll try to read the if not the, what we called in Bible college, the pericope. You remember that word?
Yeah, I do. I know the word.
Really just means paragraph or section.
Right. Yeah.
But that's a fancy
that's
Bible
a
college
word.
Word.
I hadn't thought of in a long time.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's what my professor used to say. Turn to pericope number whatever.
My professor called it the pericope.
Pericope. Now, my
he's
professor
from Missouri.
My professor would probably yell at me if I'd done that. But anyway, I look at the section. And our Bibles today really try to section off stories. Like, it'll say, here's a story of Jesus and the rich young ruler, and they'll give you that sort of, and then there are several paragraphs in that, and here's the story of Jesus and healing this person.
Right.
And so you kind of take it in that segment as well, and then, again, just start big and narrow.
And then I want to know all of those things. Mm-hmm. I want to know what translation your verse was.
Definitely.
I want to look at other translations.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
And see, we know a little bit about Greek, but I don't think you even have to know anything about Greek. If you look at enough different translations,
that's right,
you can sort of figure out where it's going. I want to know who's talking.
Yeah.
I want to know.
Who are they talking to?
Who are they talking to? What's the purpose that they're writing? All of that kind of stuff. Because all of that's really important. It's why we say you can't just read a Bible verse. And I thought Dan Kimball in his book, he gave a really good illustration of this that I thought you know, even if you're not a Bible person, if you're a Star Wars person, you might appreciate his thing. He's a Star Wars guy, and so he uses a Star Wars illustration, and it's this line. Here's the line he says. This is one line, so it'd be like a verse. He says, the line is, "Just once, let me look on you with my own eyes." Now,
that's exactly where that came from.
That's the kind of thing that, man, it would sound really good. You could print that up, and it could almost be one of those things you write to somebody you love.
It's a romantic kind
of thing. You could print it on a T-shirt, you know, all of that kind of stuff. But if you don't know the context of it, you could make a whole story up and really do violence to the overall story of Star Wars.
Yes.
Right? And not understand that particular verse is a key line for the overall arc of the whole story.
Mm-hmm.
Once somebody says to you, okay, that line is said by Anakin Skywalker.
Mm-hmm.
Now, even if you're not a Star Wars person, you don't know who that is.
He was still Darth Vader.
He was Darth Vader.
He made the turn at that point. That was the turn. That's the point of that line.
When he takes the helmet off, is that when it happens?
No, it's when he picks up Palpatine and throws him in the thing.
There could be
Palpatine's first name is Sheev, by the way. So in case you want to know that.
All right.
So now we've gotten two geeks over here to the side that have gotten this.
So we could have a debate on at what moment did Darth Vader become Anakin again?
That's right.
Okay. Well,
that's right. Like the debates that some people want to have with me, does a person become a Christian the moment they believe in Jesus or the Mormon that confess Jesus? Because the Bible says confess. But then there are other people that you and I used to be around that goes, it doesn't matter when they believe or when they confess, it's when they're in the water. But is it when their toes in the water or when they're
how much water?
The real question is, why, if you watch it on Disney Plus, when you see the Force ghost of Darth Vader at the end of Return of the Jedi, is it the Hayden Christensen version of Anakin Skywalker? Because Luke wouldn't recognize him. So Luke looks at Obi-Wan Kenobi as a young man that he'd never seen before. He just met the old man. He looks at Yoda, which he did recognize. And then there's this dude that's his dad, but he's like a teenager.
All right.
We've really taken
this illustration and gotten away from our original
point. Just saying, it's bizarre.
The original point was, if you read this thing just once, let me look in your own eyes, and you don't know who said it, you don't know who they said it to, you don't know where it comes in the story, but when you understand Anakin, who's Darth Vader,
the
whole thing, he's dying, he's had his head in the lap of his son, we now know, who's Luke Skywalker, and he's saying to Luke...
Should we say spoiler alert at any point?
No.
My God, if you have not seen Star Wars and you care right now, I don't know how to help you.
I'm kidding. That movie
came out when I was just getting out of high school.
Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I'm just saying.
I know.
Okay.
That was a bad joke. Okay, go ahead.
No, there probably are people.
Yeah, some people are screaming at
us. You have to go spoiler before you say it. Okay. Whatever. Well, you know.
Okay.
And the Maltese Falcon, that's even further.
Maltese Falcon?
That's a long time ago. That's a movie, it's black and white with Humphrey Bogart. And, you know, that was a big movie when my parents were young.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway, so once you understand Anakin's son is now holding him, and Anakin knows he's dying, and he says to his son, remove my mask so I can look at you not through the mask, with my own eyes.
Yes.
Now you get the overall thing.
I'm tearing up right now.
So why don't you give us an idea of, because most people hear what you're saying, but then they say, okay, but I don't. Okay, this comes from Ezekiel. Well, I do know in Ezekiel. Like, people don't know that. So how would a person who does not have I'm a new Christian, or even I'm not, but I don't have a lot of Bible knowledge. Someone pulls something out of, let's just take Ezekiel for, how can people, and I know you have something in the outline, so how can people understand the context of the story of the Bible in a way that would be helpful?
Well, the context of all the Bible is Jesus, and you need to know that everything in the Bible is leading to Jesus, and it's either on this side of Jesus, which is before Jesus, it's at the time of Jesus, or it's after Jesus, but everything's pointing to Jesus. If I were a new Christian and I read a verse and I don't know all of those things, first of all, I'd say to you, you need to be humble enough to begin to ask somebody how to begin to do those things. That's what I would say.
Yeah.
Don't just assume that your plain reading that you felt in your heart was what it was is absolutely... Be a little humble and begin to try to understand that. But if you could understand the storyline of the Bible, and Dan, again, outlines it, and this is one we've all heard before. You guys want to walk through the storyline for people?
Yeah, I mean, I guess the storyline we have here is the first act is that God creates. So God creates the world, and it's good. He creates human beings, and it's good. The second act is man rebels. So mankind turns away from God's goodness, and we sin. We turn away from God. The third act is that God begins the redemption begins the redemption process. So God begins at work to try and bring back his goodness into the world, or his kingdom into the world. And he works through people. So he works through a man named Abraham, then Abraham's family. That becomes the nation of Israel.
And that's pretty much the whole Old Testament except for the first two chapters of Genesis.
Sure, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Exactly right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then God, redemption is provided in Jesus, mm-hmm. is Act 4. Mm-hmm. So that's the life of Jesus, the death of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus. The community of Jesus followers take redemption to the world. That's basically the rest of the Bible from that point, the New Testament, the letters of the New Testament, and the book of Acts, which detailed the church and how the church is working. But the truth is that's also where we're at right now in
that's
the story.
Right.
Yep.
Exactly right.
And then the final one, which is really a couple of the epistles and the book of Revelation, is redemption is complete. Jesus returns, and the kingdom of God comes fully in Jesus.
The world is set right.
The where it's important is, so if I'm reading we used the illustration of Jeremiah last time, or you read the violence in the Old Testament, or you read some of the stuff, you've got to then place it on this timeline. So we used to use the illustration, if you walked into my house right after my kids dropped a bowl of a container of rice that had not been cooked, and it's broken all over the floor, and you walked in while I'm cleaning that up, you might think, man, this guy keeps a really dirty house.
Mm-hmm.
And things, he's got glass on the floor, it's dangerous for his kids. Well, if you don't know beforehand, I had a really clean house, and I provided a place for my kids to be safe, but they busted the jar.
Yeah.
And I'm now at work helping them clean it up, training them how not to do all of that. So it looks really messy, and it doesn't look exactly the way that I wanted it to be in the beginning.
Mm.
It really is important you place these verses in this process. So there's some stuff that takes place in the middle of the Old Testament where God is cleaning stuff up. Mm. He's working where people have gotten, and sin has taken people down a path, and the world has gone down a really, really, really... I mean, the ancient world is so violent.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It's hard for us to imagine how violent people are.
Yes.
So when you read the Old Testament say an eye for an eye... Even people who aren't Christian realize that code began to civilize the world, not the way we hear it and say, man, you mean if somebody could, it doesn't sound like justice that you would take a person's eye. Well, that's better if they knocked your eye out that you get to kill them.
Right.
I mean, it's a...
It was a restraint at that time.
It's a restraining of what people naturally do. And so, you know, you have these people that blood avengers would go out and you killed my brother, and so I get to hunt you down on the planet. And legally, if I catch you, I can kill you, and there's nothing to it. So the Bible begins to restrain that.
Yes.
To restrain
cities of refuge.
Yes,
remember that?
Right. Mm-hmm. So that we can have places. It's all a part of this redemption process. So you can't look at it and say, in that place, God said this, and that was what he really wanted to have take place, any more than you'd say, when I say to my kids, hey, I want you to go over and pick up that glass, that you go, that guy's having a three-year-old handle jagged glass. That's what his final will was they handle jagged glass. No, it's in the redemption process. I'm beginning to work with people. Then when Jesus comes, you see redemption begin to break out.
Absolutely.
And there are all these signs taking place to indicate a whole new kingdom is
And
coming.
Let's be clear, that's still ongoing in the epistles, or the letters that we call them at the end in the New Testament. And back to what you brought up last week, a lot of people point to some stuff in those letters and say, well, see there, God's okay with slavery because they address slaves and masters. But then you continue to read the overall direction of that. They weren't condoning this.
Right.
They were trying to put limits on it. They were trying to work within the system. And then, of course, you come to the book of Philemon, where, you know, Paul writes in and says, hey, look, you know, this, we need to free this guy. This, right. This shouldn't happen. He's a, you know,
he's a brother.
He's a brother in Christ. We should treat him that way. This is what the way human beings ought to be treated. But he didn't come in and say, you know, all of it has got to go today.
It's got to happen today. You got baptized.
Yeah.
You
he's,
do it all.
He's helping these folks come out of that because he understands where they are and what they can handle at the time. So my point is that that thing you just described doesn't just end in the Old Testament with Jesus. There's a process ongoing.
Sure.
No, and it continues today everywhere the gospel is, and even in my own life.
Yes.
And I would hope every Christian sees this. There are things at 62 that I would not think of doing. But when I was 25 and I was a Christian, I didn't even know they were a problem.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I was fully trying to follow Jesus.
Yes.
I did not know they were a problem. But the redemptive nature of God is redemption has continued to break out in my life and in my family. And if we all continue down that path, it's that thing of generations, you know, blessings go to generations, curses go to generations. If you have a family that's been deeply embedded in sin, it takes a while to untangle that in the lives of people.
Yes.
So that's the nature of it. And then eventually redemption is complete. So when you read verses again, even if you only have this of God created, man rebelled, God begins a redemption process, Jesus is the point where redemption begins to break out into the world, his community takes it out. If you can place those verses in that place, you can begin to see a little bit more of the storyline and see how does this verse fit into the story. All of Jesus has a backstory. Everything Jesus is saying has a backstory. The church has a backstory. Mm-hmm. The epistles have a backstory. They have a future in the timeline that they're pointing to. Mm-hmm. It's important to get that even if you don't understand all the things. So that's never read a Bible verse. You've got to get some of this timeline stuff going on
yep.
for there to be any sense out of it, or you get tangled up a little bit.
All right.